Yes, go. Blue is
my ass.
There we go.
Ready?
Ready? Yeah. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the first meeting of January 2017. This is a meeting of the Planning, Building, and Environmental Committee. And I am Joanne Chichok, and I'll be chairing tonight's meeting. Actually, I am the chair now. We've rotated around, so I'm not just acting. I'm the real chair. Now, any items, any requests to change the order of items on the agenda? Given there's one, I expect to see none. But I'm asking now a disclosure of pecuniary interest and or conflict of interest by members of committee. Seeing none, we'll move on. Appointments. Tonight we have one appointment, and that is from the IBI Group, and Mr. Arians, I see, is here. So welcome, Mr. Arians, and we look forward to your presentation. This is regarding the rezoning draft plan of condominium and site plan agreement for, actually, who is the applicant?
So, Madam Chair, Mr. Mayor, members of council, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. The applicant is Ralph Severino. He is the property owner and developer, and with me is David Samus from Phelps Homes. Phelps are the purchasers and will ultimately be developing this property. This being the first meeting, I need to first of all apologize for having missed your last meeting of December. Reason being, your meetings are on Mondays. The Saturday before, both my son and my daughter had their Christmas parties to go to, and as grandpa we babysat the kids, and two of them had stomach flus, and naturally you get it passed on to you, so I was not able to come to the meeting on Monday in December, and young Jared was kind of thrown into the fire on my behalf, and I apologize for that. Perhaps he was not as prepared as he should have been. We do have a PowerPoint presentation to go over this development project, and I'd like to share that with you if I may.
And Mr. Arians, pardon me, it is the Christmas season, and everyone is full of love and joy and wishing good health and happiness into the new year. So we wish all of those things to you, and we forgive you for not making our last meeting and not allowing us to close the year with closure on this item. Thank you very much for that explanation.
So what is before us is a 54-unit condominium townhouse development within the Streamside subdivision. I understand that the issues Planning Committee considered were the interface with the residents to the south and the frontage development along Streamside Drive. So those are the two issues that we were dealing with. Now, with respect to the interface with the residents along the south, you'll see on the site plan that there is an additional planting area now proposed along the northerly boundary of the flood easement or the spillway in this location. So additional planting and a privacy fence has been added. In addition, the zoning bylaw also will prohibit any second floor balconies from these units backing onto the single family homes to the south. So I think we've addressed that interface quite nicely. We have townhouses backing onto singles. It's a rear yard to rear yard transition, which is appropriate. And the setback for the closest dwelling, I believe, or to the lot line, is over 19 meters. So there's very generous setbacks, very generous landscaping and fencing is proposed. With respect to the interface along Streamside Drive, my understanding is that committee and council were concerned that the development as proposed had a landscaping strip, a parking area, a driveway, and then townhouse units. And I think what was suggested was, could you consider taking this row of townhouses and having them front directly on Streamside, but still be accessed from a rear laneway? We call those park models, where you have either, you know, the units face open space or a park, or they face a street, and then they're accessed from the rear. We considered those options previously when Mr. Severino first hired us to do different design options. In fact, we had probably a dozen or so different options. We considered direct frontage development on Streamside. We considered backlotting. We considered the window street format, which is before you today. And we considered that rear access lane. The primary consideration in support of this plan are a number of factors, and I'd like to review those with the committee. First and foremost, the window street is preferred because it creates one point of entry into this development, and that point of entry, of course, is right in this location, and it's directly opposite St. Martin's School driveway. If we were to do the window street, or sorry, the rear access lane component, this area with the, we wouldn't be able to maintain the driveway in this area. The driveway would have to be shifted slightly to the south, and then it would extend north, and there would be a block of townhouses in this location. That resulted in this portion of the plan being extremely awkward to redesign by maintaining a driveway in this location. So it meant that the driveway would then be offset from St. Martin's School, which is not a major component, but it is still significant because we would then have competing left turns, someone turning left into the development and someone coming north on Streamside turning into the school. They would be in a competing situation. Now, normally a school and a subdivision operate at different peak times, and it's not that significant, but I know that this council is very concerned with safety. When we did St. Martin's School, we had to extend the sidewalk along Highway 20, we had to put a crosswalk in, we had to put warning signs, speed reduction signs. So anything that would cause attention to this intersection, and particularly where children are active, we felt it was best not to have the offsetting driveways, but to rather have the driveway directly opposite. So it's a safe, controlled access point in this location. Phelps Homes are also gearing this development towards families, and the project is called Stepping Stones because young families buy a townhouse, they save their money, they get their equity, they then step up to a different product. Hopefully, Phelps Homes will sell them that single family or that semi-detached home. So it's important to have amenity space for the residents. And when you have the park models or the front-facing townhouses that face a street, they have a very small yard in the front, and that yard has basically a walkway to the sidewalk, and that's all you can use it for. You can't really picnic or barbecue or put your wading pool there. That has to go in the backyard, and of course the backyard is where your driveway and your garage is, so your patch of grass, your landscaped amenity area in the backyard is very small, and typically from an urban design perspective you can't even fence it because it's open to that driveway area, and you don't want to create these privacy fences on these very small amenity areas. So to maximize the amount of rear yard amenity area, the more conventional form of townhousing was proposed rather than those rear accessed units. So if rear access was proposed, there would almost be no rear yard amenity space whatsoever. And keep in mind, as a family development, you've got your kids, you can't play in a fenced-in backyard because you can't fence your backyard because it's right beside your parking area and visibility needs to be maintained. So rear access units are also typically much closer to the street. You're familiar with Livingston Avenue in Grimsby before the town hall, a number of townhouses front onto that street. They have their little laneways and then their access to the back. But that really is an urban form of development as opposed to a more suburban type of development like the Streamside subdivision. It's really out of character with Streamside. Streamside is more suburban with larger front yards, more generous setbacks, and I think if you're creating that type of urbanism, let's do it comprehensively rather than on the last block in a development. And doing it comprehensively, perhaps on the lands to the north, which are being brought into the urban boundary and you're doing a secondary plan, if that's the feeling this council wants to get, put it in your urban design guidelines and that whole neighborhood would then be consistent rather than doing it just on one particular block. So from an overall safety perspective and from an overall urban design perspective, we feel that this is a much better design for the Streamside subdivision. This is an example of the landscaping that will be proposed along that street edge. Plantings, wrought iron fencing, brick pillars. So we will be landscaping that edge along Streamside Drive. It will be owned by the condominium block. It will be professionally maintained, and it will create a good, solid entrance and a very aesthetic streetscape in this location. These are the townhouse units that Phelps will be building, and these are the units that will face the Window Street, which will then face Streamside Drive. This is our artist perspective, showing the, you know, more or less a three-dimensional view, starting at the corner of Highway 20 and Streamside, looking in a direction down the subdivision. And you'll see that while a parking area is proposed for visitor parking, the views of that parking area will be filtered. They will be somewhat obscured by the plantings and the landscaping that will occur in this area. And this is a view of the entrance leading into the development. Again, entry features all along the frontage and the main driveway. So the additional plantings that are proposed, the landscape treatment, and you see the landscaping along the Highway 20 and Streamside Drive, it will result in a highly aesthetic design. It complies with your urban design guidelines, and we would respectfully request that the plan as originally contemplated and as originally designed in December receive your approval. Now, I know that the staff have made revisions to the bylaw. That's incorporating some of the plantings and incorporating the prohibition on the decks, and we feel that's appropriate as well. So I know Mr. Samus has a few words on behalf of Phelps, and with your permission, I'll just turn it over to him.
Thank you, yes. And that would be the December plan as modified.
Correct, as modified.
So with it's not the same plan.
The additional plantings have been added.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you, John. So my name is David Samus. I'm with Phelps Homes here tonight. We do thank members of the committee, staff, and the public that we have met with and spoke to. As you know, Stepping Stones, as Mr. Ayans has mentioned, has been contemplated for some time. Phelps Homes and us, the developer, have put a lot of thought since our meeting in December as into the plan and options. And so we do feel this plan is a great plan as far as representing the concerns that have been identified to us over the last month. So we're quite confident that this plan is a good plan with the enhancements and the details provided. We're pleased with the landscaping and the frontage to the development that helped to frame the street in. And we do believe it's going to create an asset for the community once built. We do build good, we do care a lot about the design, so we think it's going to be a good development for the gateway to Smithville. And just in closing, we are very excited about the project. We think it's going to be a great opportunity for Smithville. And in closing, we're appreciative of Township Planning staff, members of the committee, and for the public for the dialogue we've had the last couple of weeks. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Samus. Are there any... Oh, that's our delegation, so we'll move on to the report shortly. I'm not going to accept questions from committee at this point is what I meant. Sorry. We'll just go on to, since there's only one item on the agenda. There is time now for the public to address items on the agenda, and this would be the appropriate time to come forward. So I see a hand already at the back. If you'd come forward and give us your name. And I apologize, I forget names, so you'll have to repeat it.
It's Marion Gowing. From 29 Streamside Drive, yes. Madam Chair and Council Members. As you know, I've been here before stating some of my, the issues that the 58 people had that signed the petition. And I think that in the last week, I have also met with David Sams, with Ross Murray, and we discussed the changes that they were proposing to put forth to enhance the development. The parking on Streamside has never really been an issue for us, the parking mostly. The issue that we've raised was the height of the back, so the 15 units that back onto the easement. Nothing's been said about that. I did ask a question on Friday to David to explain to me why is the reason that they are not putting the basements of those 15 units into the ground because the adjacent house on the other side is Ross Murray's house, and he has a full basement, and it's in the ground. I was told that it was they thought it might be an engineering problem having to do with putting in the services. I would really like to have that information put forth to us so that we know, is it actually that reason, or is it because it's going to cost more money to put those basements in the ground and make the adjustments to the sewage and the services that obviously have to run up to the pump house, or I don't know. I'm actually not an engineer, and I don't know the actual answers. But I would really like to have that made clear. Is it just a monetary thing that Phelps needs to, or Catalina and Phelps need to build these 15 townhomes on grade to totally ruin the transition between the townhome complex and our survey in Streamside? Or is it monetary? Monetary, or is it an engineering thing that has to happen, that that these townhomes all have to be on the same grade? And I'd really like that question answered. So, yes, it's nice that they've agreed to put in the 15-foot trees. I think that's great. They aren't really going to create much of a buffer between the townhomes and our survey because it's in a hollow anyway. It's down low. Our homes are up higher than that. And the first floor of these units, the living space of the first floor, are going to be still looking over above our fences in our backyards. So that particular issue's never really been addressed, other than the fact, oh, I guess they can do it, they're going to do it, and I would like to actually have it clarified if it is, in fact, an expense or it's an engineering difficulty. And that's really... And I really do appreciate David Sams talking to us. I think he's a gentleman in his own right, for sure, and has tried very hard to keep the communication lines open with us. But this particular issue about transition has been the number one thing on our list of concerns right from day one. That's why I came. That's why we came with the petition. And really, it hasn't been addressed.
Thank you, Mrs. Skelling. Are there others wishing to speak? Is there anyone else? Okay, that's fine.
Ross Murray, 25 Streamside Drive.
Good evening, Mr. Murray.
I would like to assure the chair that I've written my comments down this evening.
Thank you. That's only for the clerk, not for me.
Very, very brief.
Thank you.
I would like to thank those councillors that have pushed back at the developers at the December planning meeting. And I would particularly like to thank Councillor Bell for his efforts since then to resolve some of the issues. Our main concern has always been the proposed height of the townhouses abutting the Streamside subdivision, which will have the greatest impact on the quality of our lives moving forward. In 2012, Streamside Development Corporation and Township of West Lincoln reached an agreement through an Ontario Municipal Board process that would restrict the height of townhouses to two stories. When I'm looking out my bedroom window or sitting on my deck, I will be staring at a three-story structure. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Oh. It's okay. Writing them out only works if you give them to them.
Thank you.
Thanks. Don Kozak, 21 Creekview Drive.
Welcome, Mr. Kozak.
Thank you. Madam Chair, the question I have is the urban design. I was reviewing the urban design manual, and we say, or somebody says, that it's in line with the urban design manual. And one of the things I picked up on is in the urban design is the facade or the face of the home. And when I look at can somebody put that picture back up of the development?
Oh, the slide.
The slide. And what I'm looking at, or what I'm talking about, is the T-intersection of Gateway and Streamside. And that's where that new housing development's going, on the left-hand side, or across the street. When you either come up Streamside or come off Gateway, you basically drive into that new development, or make the left-hand turn and drive into that development. All you'll see is the back of the three-story home. The urban design says that's not supposed to happen. Can somebody answer me?
What I'm doing is I'm taking note of your
okay.
questions, and we're listening to the public, and when we come to the issue, members of council, members of committee may pose those questions for you, or we will direct them to staff.
Yeah. It talks about gateway nodes on corner lots, T-intersections, or directly adjacent to open spaces, parks, trails, natural areas, agricultural lands. Additional articulation is required for publicly visible elevations of dwellings on priority lots. And those lots are priority lots. So the question not only goes to Streamside and Gateway, but also what's facing Highway 20 and what's facing inside the development itself. The other part on the urban design is the compatibility with adjacent built forms. The urban design says that these shall be compatible with the
adjacent
houses that are there. As far as I'm concerned, what Ross has to look at, a three-story home backing onto his bungalow, is not compatible. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kozak. Are there others wishing to address committee this evening? No? Okay. I'm going to ask one more time. Is there anyone else wishing to address committee this evening? Mr. Arians, I think we'll leave the response to the questions till we get into the item itself on the agenda, okay? Okay. There are no consent. I'm moving on, since we have no other speakers to the item. And by the way, as most of you will remember, we did in December agree not to postpone our January meeting. We basically had no meeting in January as the position that was before council at the time, but we chose to put this planning meeting on strictly to deal with this item. And I say that because there were a number of other people who have applications that were wanting to bring them forward. So we maintained an agenda of just this one item. So there are no consent agenda items. There's no communications. Therefore, I'm looking at the staff report, item PDP0217, which is from pages 4 to 95 with a recommendation. I can read the recommendation first, then members of committee can ask their questions, and our staff will give us a response to outstanding matters. The recommendation is that report PD15316 regarding condominium development, Catalina Construction and Landscaping Corporation, application for rezoning and draft plan of condominium, and authority to enter site plan agreement, file number 1601-012-16, 2083-16, dated December 12, 2016, be received. That the application for zoning bylaw amendment 1601-012-16 submitted by IBI Group Inc. be approved. That section 3417 of the Planning Act apply, and that no further public meetings are required, and that application for draft plan of condominium 2000-083-16 submitted by IBI Group Inc. be approved as per attachment 4 in accordance with the provisions of the Planning Act, RSO 1990, Chapter P13 regulations thereunder, subject to conditions contained in attachment number 5, PD15316. That the applicant be advised that the township's draft approval of this plan of condominium will lapse 3 years from the date of its draft approval unless Township Council grants an extension of the approved approval period. If an extension is requested, an updated review will occur and revisions to the conditions of the approval may be necessary at that time. And finally, that a bylaw be passed to authorize the mayor and clerk to sign the final site plan and site plan agreement upon the recommendation of the township staff. I need a mover to put that on the table. Mover, Mayor Joyner, and seconded by Councillor Bell. Okay, those wishing to speak to this item. Seeing no one, I see someone. I thought that was strike a chord. Councillor Bell.
Just want to just touch on the urban plan for a minute.
Urban design?
Yeah, urban design, because it was brought up by Mr. Arians and brought up by the residents. And my comment is that to you, Madam Chair, I'd like to request that the urban design come back on the next planning meeting in February, that we can refer to staff and start having a conversation about that design. And if it can't be put on the February planning committee, then I'd like to know so that I can go to the mayor and have it put onto the council meeting on the 23rd. I think it's important that we deal with this issue with the urban design.
Well, Councilor Bell, I certainly hear your concern about the urban design. It's been brought up by a number of people, yourself, residents, and the proponents. So certainly we will, if the urban design guidelines need to come forward, which it sounds like there is a misunderstanding or they are not quite right yet for what it is Smithville needs, West Lincoln needs, we need to review them and revise them, or at least take a look at them and have staff do a study group with council again so that we understand what's going on. So I have no problem in working that through with you've been along way for too long, Mr. Treble, to determine whether it's council or the next planning meeting, but we'll address the needs and how we can best get everybody up to speed.
Can I take that to mean it'll be on the next planning meeting?
It'll be on the next planning. We'll have something on the next planning to talk about the urban design guidelines and to determine what areas, if any, require clarification and how members of committee would like to address that. Okay? And I'm sure that we won't get it all done in one meeting, so we'll probably end up getting referred back to that's exactly the point. Okay. Councillor Ganan.
I'd just like to, first of all, say that I was disappointed at the last meeting that it seemed that the exact same plan came back without really any consideration of what the residents had asked for. So I was encouraged to see that there was some dialogue with residents this time, and I appreciate both our staff and the other staffs being part of that, and including the residents. I'm not sure, being new, if this is the time to ask the question that Mrs. Gowling asked about. What is going on with that? Is that something that can be changed, or is that a bedrock situation or some kind of a drainage situation that we're unaware of that allows for their request not to be met?
I think we'll put that to Mr. Treble, and he can get support from the proponents if he wishes to turn it there. Can you turn your phone on with that thing?
I got it. Thank you, Madam Chair. I have to advise I can't answer the question that was posed by Marion Gowling. I don't know the answer. We'd have to discuss with Public Works and take a look at the engineering plans internal to the township to get a sense of that. Agents can answer the question, but as of right now, I can't answer that question. My apologies.
Mr. Arians, would you like to speak to that issue, please? This isn't a public meeting, but I think we want to get the air cleared as much as we can about all the issues out there. So we're going to keep going back and forward.
So first and foremost, Madam Chair, we are not seeking any adjustments to the height regulations of your zoning bylaw. As proposed, this development fully complies with your height in the bylaw. There's a suggestion that we're ruining the transition. Well, we're not. I mean, there are rear walkouts in single-family homes in the midst of the Streamside subdivision. It's a common practice where grades accommodate it, and there are a number of factors that are considered. There's a cut-and-fill balance on the subdivision. There's proper grading. There's proper drainage patterns. The site does have to be raised slightly in order to tip down to the stormwater management facility to the east. So there are grading, there are servicing, and also a walkout, a basement walkout is a very desirable type of unit as well. Again, young families, the stepping stones, the ability to use a basement with a walkout is a desirable factor. So all these features influence the design of the development and result in those townhouses backing onto the singles as being the walkouts. Again, the height of the building will not change whether there's a basement walkout or not. The height remains the same. The transition from the two-story townhouses to one and two-story single-family homes is appropriate. It was suggested that it's not compatible. The planning definition of compatibility does not mean to be the same as. It does not even mean to be similar to. It means to coexist in harmony with. We can make a drive-through of a Tim Hortons compatible with residential, with screening and buffering and landscaping. A drive-through can coexist next to single-family homes. Two-story, two-and-a-half-story, three-story townhouses can coexist with one-story, two-story, two-and-a-half-story singles. They're at an appropriate scale. They're at an appropriate transition. And plus, we have over a 19-meter separation, which is going to be fenced and landscaped. So it is a compatible interface. It is an appropriate transition. It will result in these families having a larger floor area for their families to use and enjoy.
Mr. Sines? Just to add further to Mr. Arians, walkout homes are actually more costly to build because there's different construction courses of brick have to run down deeper into the face of the building as well. So from our experience, walkouts are actually more expensive structure to build in a standard basement or a lookout basement condition as well.
Don't go too far away, gentlemen. I have a funny feeling there'll be other questions. Councillor Ganahan, you still have the floor.
Thank you.
Okay. Councillor Trombetta, please.
Thank you, Councillor Shishik, but Mr. Arians answered the questions I was asking. It was just this confusion that some of the residents are getting between a three-story and a two-story was the concern. So you answered those questions. So the only other question I did have was just, it was brought up, was they were saying there was going to be no walkout from the second story. There would be no, like, raised patio or deck that comes out to the... Or there will be a constructed deck, and then obviously like the walkout will be a walkout underneath the deck. Is that the way it's kind of constructed at that area there, Mr. Arians?
Through you, Madam Chair. I mean, typically your basement would have a patio walkout.
Correct.
Your
yeah.
kitchen is generally on the ground floor, mm-hmm. and there will typically be a small deck outside the kitchen area with stairs going down. The prohibition would be preventing that decks on that second floor. Because that would be coming off the bedroom wing.
Yeah, which I knew that, so there will be, like I said, a deck coming out of this.
There will be a deck off the ground floor, which would be the kitchen area over yeah. top of that walkout, yes.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Are there any other questions at this point? Just for a point of clarity, Mr. Arians, and I think I know the answer to this, but the height of a single family home that was built, that would be built there, would it be the same height? You mentioned two and a half story homes. So if you had a 2.5 story home there, would that be the same height as these towns? Roughly.
I think Mr. Treble can correct me if I'm wrong, but the height for a single is 11 and a half meters. And for these townhouses, it's 11 and a half meters too. They're the same height.
That's what I thought the answer height. Was. Yeah. So I just wanted to know what the difference is. So, thank you. I have one other question, and that is, I heard great thanks and regard for a number of conversations that had happened between everybody, and I know I was party to a few of those, but have you been involved in a number of conversations, and has there been any regard given to the questions that were posed to you to come up with this modified plan that we see before us tonight? Modified for landscaping and more buffering?
Definitely, Madam Chair. We've had a lot of conversations with residents, phones, emails. I've reviewed their past submissions, put into their agendas as well. So we did spend a lot of regard ourselves communicating with the developer to make sure we were able to address those concerns, and I think the result of the landscaping plan is a further demonstration of that as well. So we have had a lot of discussions and taken those into account.
Thank you. Doug, do you want to let Mrs. Cummings speak again? Mayor Joyner.
Thank you. I'm not sure if I'm on here or not. Yes,
you are.
I am. I see a hand up in the back, and we don't usually allow this, but I just want to ask quickly, Madam Chair, if you have a problem with, if council has a problem with having Mrs. Gowling speak one more time.
Unless I see other tension from the members of committee, I think that what we said was today would be kind of, let's get this thing nailed down. So it's beyond where we usually let the public speak. Mrs. Gowling, if you'd like to come forward.
Madam Chair, council members. The Streamside community does have two stories and does have bungalows, but when that survey was designed, the bungalow roofs and the two-story roofs, the bungalows have been built so that they blend in quite well with the two-story homes. Yes, there are some walkouts on Creek View, but they are bungalows. They aren't two stories with a walkout below. And so with that walkout, you have a very gentle blending of the houses as you go down the street. There might be a two-story, there might be a bungalow, and it's the bungalows that have the walkout. So you're not looking at three stories at the back because there is only two stories. There's the ground level and the walkout down below because of the creek being there. Well, those were the last lots that were available in the survey with the walkout. I actually looked at one myself, but I didn't want to have to go down to the lower level to do my barbecuing. Now, when they're talking about the backs of these townhomes being three-story, well, they are three-story. The basement is exposed. The first floor is there, and now apparently there's going to be a deck and maybe possibly stairs down off that deck into the backyard. And then, of course, no balconies at the top, which is the third floor that we're looking at, not the second floor. So I think there's kind of like a misconception. Not everybody, I don't know if everyone has ever walked out, gone out to look at this four-acre piece of property and actually see what we're going to see by having three stories in the back. And if it is more expensive to dig, to have walkouts, I'm a realtor and have been for 30 years, so I understand both pros and cons about people who want to walk out and people who don't want to walk out or want to walk straight out from their living space area. But if it is more expensive, then why are they doing this to the residents at Streamside with these 15 units? Why not build the basements in the ground? So we're only looking at the two stories. We're looking at the ground floor and the one story up, because right now they're building, as far as I understand, and I could be wrong, they're building them on grade. And on grade will make the first floor, which would be the front door entrance floor, above the fence that runs down between our homes and the new townhomes. It's the only argument that I have, and today there should be some culpability for people to take into consideration how it's going to impact us. Okay,
thank you, Mrs. Gowling. Okay, I will, Mayor Joyner first.
Well, thank you, Madam Chair. I would like to ask Mr. Trouble if I could. Mr. Trouble, can you please explain what the environmental feature is in the rear of these yards that you need this type of two-story with a walkout down to grade? What is the environmental feature that runs along the back of this?
Through you, Madam Chair, I'll answer the question if I can share my own thought on a response too.
Absolutely, I was going to you next.
Thank you. The 11-meter strip of land that runs between this development and the Streamside development, running from Streamside Drive easterly towards the storm outlet, is an overland flow route.
Can I just ask, is there a picture? Can we put that picture up just for anybody? I'm picturing it, but we have a visual. Sorry.
It's on the laptop screen.
Oh, there it is. Thank you.
So this strip through here, Madam Chair, that strip is an overflow route. Should the streets and that fill up with water in the existing development, the water is intended to flow overland onto that area as an area to accommodate the excess waters. I think it's the 1-in-100-year storm event that puts it to that level. So it's a pretty significant event. But the grade there is lower because of the fact that it's intended to take the water off of the roads. So that certainly has some impact on the ability to raise the lands as you go north or either side of that 11-meter easement, for that matter. Tied to that, Madam Chair, if I can just say, I know there's concern about height, and the number of stories has clearly been a topic of discussion, but I need to say with some clarity, it's not an issue that's before committee for adjustment tonight. The height was negotiated in 2012 as part of the OMB agreement, and it was two stories then, and it still, by definition, tonight is two stories. It looks like three stories from the rear, but by definition, under the zoning bylaw, it's a two-story unit with a walkout basement. So there is no ask by the developer or the applicant to change the height requirement of the zoning bylaw.
So, Mr. Treble, just to that point, if we were to change the definition of what that house looked like, it's a two-story with a walkout. Can you think of anything that would describe it differently? Because it's, I mean, we're hearing it's a slab on grade and with three stories when I look at the back, but at the front it's only two stories. Right? Am I right? Yes.
It will appear that way, but it won't be a slab on grade because it would have to have four-foot foundations in order to achieve frost levels. So there will be foundation under the rear part. It just it looks like you're just walking out. And that's the nature of the land. It's the nature of the layout of the land in that area to do it that way.
So if I look at the houses that were built along the 20 Creek, oh, I don't know where I'm talking about, but who are right against the 20 Creek who have a walkout, they're bungalows. They look like two stories from the back.
You have a mix of two stories and singles, mainly singles, I think, in the Brookside area. But there are some two stories as you head to the north end of phase three as well.
Whatever. So those are, none of them are three stories and most of them aren't two stories. That's really what we're saying.
Most of them are one stories.
With a walkout.
And the extra high ones are two stories, but they look the same.
Okay.
Madam Chair, sorry.
Sorry, Mr. Mayor, I'm going to let, I think I interjected on Mr. Treble, and I'll come back to you. Yes.
One final point, just for the record, and the clerk's already tapped me on the shoulders. Just to point out, the report as presented last month stands, save and except for the memorandum, which is on pages 97 to 99, which changes attachment 2 to that report by adding a new zoning bylaw as the zoning bylaw to be approved if the report goes through tonight. And so in that memorandum and the attachments at 97 to 99, that's where it outlines, as outlined by John Arians, the various additional landscaping provisions that have been added in. So they're in writing in the bylaw so that when the site plan goes through and the plan of subdivision gets approved, it's required that they achieve these in order to comply with zoning. So the 15-foot high trees, the coniferous trees, the solid board-on-board fencing, and the wrought iron and decorative brick pillar requirements, they're all part of this provision, as well as the no second-story decks or balconies provision. They're in that amended bylaw, which is attached to the memorandum.
So the watermark, the draft on this would not mean
should it be supported tonight, it would disappear by the time the bylaws passed by council.
Thank you. Mayor Joyner.
Thank you. I just wanted to ask a quick question of Mr. Samus and Mr. Arians. Mr. Samus, when we met, we discussed some wrought iron and brick pillars along Streamside, but we also discussed a little bit of wrought iron and brick pillar along Highway 20 to kind of present a symmetrical view looking southward off of Highway 20. I do not see that in your landscaping diagram. Is that just an oversight, or you're not putting it in there?
Mr. Mayor, through Madam Chair, no, there is going to be there. It's just a matter of getting enough time to get everything properly prepared for Monday night. The intent is to do landscaping and...
And Mr. Mayor, just to make sure, it's attractive and decorative wrought iron fencing and brick pillars shall be installed along the perimeter of the development adjacent to Streamside Drive and Regional Road 20, which shall be depicted on the site plan, and that is on page 98. Just so happen to find it.
Thank you. Thank you.
It is there.
It is there. Okay. Thank you. I didn't see it.
Don't leave. I think Mayor Joyner is done. Councillor Trombetta.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just to Mr. Samus. The trees that are going to be planted, sorry, I know you guys are, and John are looking for something there. Do you guys want to bring that up, John, or just to, okay?
Where do I go, which way do I go on here?
It's in the words, in the bylaw, so, and in the memorandum.
Yeah, it's also there. I don't have a pointer. Through you, Madam Chair, to the Mayor. Yes, so there, the symmetry is shown on plant B. It is hard to see.
Okay.
And but it is there. So we've shown fence on Highway 20, and there's another elevation drawing I'm going to take you to next. But there actually is a color in there, and I think this would be a good time to distribute those. Brian.
Sure.
We've actually got hard copies. They're a little easier to see. Sorry, this is stuff I've been running around trying to get ready in advance of tonight, so David didn't have a chance to get into this.
Thank you.
Now, on this screen, the top elevation, is facing streamside.
Yeah.
The bottom elevation is actually part of the visual from 20 into the site. So you'll see here, there's a gate.
Yes.
That's at the very edge of it. That's the end of it, and then the walkway. So that would be the westernmost walkway. And then there's just landscaping. And then on the other end on that site plan, you'll see there's more pillar and fence and a walkway at the east end of the site. So there's a bit of a gap of the fence on the Highway 20, just so you can just see into the site and get the lens is full of landscaping.
Very good. Thank you, sir. Thank you, David. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Councillor Trombetta.
Thank you. To Mr. Samus, the trees that are getting planted on the backside against the adjacent houses, they're mature trees, correct, is what you guys stated. It's not a typical thing that majority of townhouses, complexes do is plant trees, but you guys have went over and above to decide to accommodate with some tree planting, which is always good. Now, the size and diameter of the trees, just to check, like, what's the typical size and the diameter of tree that's going in there for the backside of...
Through Councillor Trombetta, planning chair to Councillor Trombetta, those are 15-foot trees, so the width of the, not an arborist, but they will be substantial enough. They're trees that are 15-foot as borderline field stock versus stuff that has to be tree spaded in, so they are substantial
trees. Size trees.
And beyond normal course for other developments.
And again, that's over and above typically on what, you know, townhouse blocks do. That you guys have put forward to accommodate some of these areas, correct?
Yes, if you drive through Atwater, the project we just finished up in the fall, these are very, very mature trees compared to what was planted there. Not to speak, you know, they are substantial, more than the normal.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Samus. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. I think you can rest, Mr. Samus. I'm not seeing any more hands from members of committee either. So I want to thank everybody who had a hand in trying to bring this to resolve. I know that people worked expeditiously in the past week or so to try and come to some understanding. I leave it now to my colleagues. I have a motion on the floor as read. Sorry, I got to go back to the item. I am looking for, since there are no other comments, a vote on this item, and I'm going to ask all in favor to so indicate. Seeing no one contrary-minded, I would suggest that that motion is approved. Thank you. There is an item of other business on this, but I believe Councillor Bell has indicated, and we will be back. Councillor Bell, I assure you that staff and I will talk briefly after this, and we'll get this onto the agenda for the next planning, if not before, because I think there is a number of members of council over the past couple of weeks have been wondering how exactly the urban design guidelines are meant to read and what's meant by their definitions as to what we've learned in this particular application. Thank you for bringing that forward. Okay. There are no matters of new business requiring a motion, I presume, having seen no hands, and there's no confidential matters. This would bring a time for adjournment of this meeting at, I declare it adjourned at 7:22. Thank you so much. This evening, we have admin as well as Public Works and Recreation following this meeting, so I'll remove myself from the chair, and we'll take a 2-second break as we let the next chair up.